days are filled with laughter. My heart has known your peace. I've traveled far, still there is far to go. 'Cause in my heart there is a longing to look upon your face. Where you are is where I want to be.
Well, good morning. Merry Christmas Eve, and we want to welcome you to our services here at Southside Baptist Church this morning. If you are one of our guests here today, I know there are some churches not having a service this morning, but if you're one of our guests, we want to welcome you here to Southside Baptist Church. If you don't have a church home and you may be searching, ask the Lord for a place to attend. There is a little card in front of you and a seat in front of you. If you just gratefully just fill that card out, leave it on the seat. As you are dismissed this morning, we'd be grateful of that, have a record of your visit, get a chance to visit with you, tell you more about Southside Baptist Church. A couple announcements I want to let you know about today. If you didn't get a bulletin, please, you can pick one up. One is a sweet announcement. Don't get that? A sweet announcement. Someone brought in a bunch of candy. Out there in the foyer and by the coffee area as well. So on your way out today, take a big handful of candy and sweeten yourself up on your way home, all right? So thank you for that. That was given to us. Also, just a note, beginning, we have one more Sunday in December, and then the first Sunday in January. All the way through the month of January, we're going to be doing our own church directory, so there's no cost to anyone. Danny Young's going to be taking those pictures. We've had a few folks ask if you have to sign up. You do not have to sign up. All you need to do is to come ready on the day that works best for you on that January, on that Sunday, and you come, and Danny will be ready to take your family photos. So just be mindful of that. That will be set up and ready before Sunday school, in between church, after church, but preferably not during church. All right? Also, there's a couple volunteer opportunities that we always want to keep in front of you here at Southside. If you are looking for a place to volunteer for the new year, we always have needs for people to be greeters. That is, pass out the bulletins and welcome people into our fellowship on Sunday morning. First impressions are a big thing. So when they walk through the doors there at Southside, they need to be greeted with a friendly voice and a friendly smile, and to welcome them to God's house. The other one is, the other volunteer opportunity is to provide a youth meal, a meal for our youth on Wednesday nights. Now, in providing that, the church takes care of that cost. So if it's something you want to order from Zaxby's or something like that, all you have to do is sign up, write your name down on that date, let them know Miss Mary Lisa's heading that up, and that way you'll be able to put on the calendar and making sure that that is taken care of as well. Also, on the very back, little counter back there on your way out, I have two things for you. If we can pick up one per family, we'd be grateful of that. A couple of you have already picked those up. January 7th, we're going to be introducing you to a candidate that we have to bring on staff for our next full-time staff person here at Southside, our ministry administrator, and that individual is going to be presented to you, and he's going to share his testimony on January 7th. And then on January 14th, we will vote whether or not to call him to our staff here at Southside. In the back is his resume and also the job description. There's two papers there that you can pick up. And if you just graciously pick those up on your way out, and we'll do the best we can to answer any questions. But we're just praying that the Lord have his favor upon our fellowship as we bring on another staff person, and looking forward to doing that. All right. Well, it's a good day to be in God's house. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. We'll continue our service. Lord, we love you. We praise you. Lord, thank you for waking us up today. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to celebrate Jesus, the coming of our Savior. Thank you for the opportunity that we get as a family of God, as believers in Christ, to come and to hear songs that are sung and praises and the Word of God spoken. And God, I pray that if there's anyone here in this room this morning who's yet to come to Christ as our personal Savior and Lord, may the Spirit of God speak to their heart today. What a beautiful gift it would be for someone to receive the perfect gift, Jesus Christ as our personal Savior and Lord. God, we just pray that you lead us and guide us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning. Let's stand together and sing this morning. A good old song, Beautiful Star of Bethlehem.
Beautiful star of Bethlehem.
sing another song. It came upon a midnight clear. Is froggy this morning, but I could sing a mean bass this morning. But anyway, that song we did first was in our cantata. If you wasn't able to hear our cantata, if you wasn't, it's going to be aired today at 2 o'clock on Glasgow Electric Plant Board's channel 6. So if you missed it, you can watch it today or watch it on Facebook. The song the praise team's going to do now is one that we did during the Hanging of the Greens entitled Light of the World.
Light of the world,
Amen. Amen. Great job, choir. Great job, worship team. Great job, church, for singing this morning. Amen. We love to sing those songs. If you have your Bible for just a few moments before we partake of the elements today, would you turn your Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 1. The Gospel of John, chapter 1, this morning. As we walk through a passage of Scripture, beginning in verse number 1, I'm going to read from verse 1 through verse 18. It will not be on the screen in front of you this morning. There will be only one verse that is there in just a moment, but I'd invite you to turn your Bibles to John chapter number 1, beginning in verse number 1, all the way through verse number, it says verse 14, but I'm going to read through verse 18 today. John chapter 1, the Gospel of John, did you find that? The Word of God says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through Him, and apart from Him, nothing came into being that has come into being. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. There came a man sent from John, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify about the light so that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to testify about the light. There was the true light which, coming into the world, enlightens every man. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw His glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified about Him and cried out, saying, 'This was He of whom I said, He who comes after me has a higher rank than I, for He existed before me. For of His fullness we have all received, and grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth were realized through Jesus Christ. For no one has seen God at any time. The only begotten of God, who is in the bosom of the Father, He has explained Him.'" Or some translations may say, "He made Him known." I want you to go back to verse number 14. That one is on the screen. It says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw His glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth." Let's pray, go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, would you reveal yourself to us today? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. One pastor said it this way, and I quote, he said, "We need to realize that this passage of Scripture, this account, is the most astounding miracle in the entire Bible. That miracle is that God became flesh, that God became a man." Now, I agree with that assessment. I agree with that statement. John tells us that Jesus Christ, the Word, became flesh and dwelt among us. As a matter of fact, in verse number 14, John tells us that Jesus was full of grace and truth. Now, what does that mean? That word truth, it's an interesting word. It's used in John's Gospel at least 21 times in John's Gospel. But what does that mean? What does the word truth actually mean? Well, it can mean two things. Truth can be a concept, meaning what I just said was true, or truth can be in person. And in this situation, we're talking about a person. Truth, in this passage of Scripture, is talking about a person. He says here in John chapter 1, in verse number 14, he says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw His glory, glory as the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth." Now, church, was there truth in Jesus? Well, the answer to that is yes. But before you can find out the truth that is in Jesus, you have to understand that truth is Jesus, that He is a person. It's not a concept, even though that may be a reality. He is a person. And in John's Gospel, there are several references that I can call your attention to that reveal to us about this truth. Let me just give these to you. They will not be on the screen, but just listen to what the Word of God says. John 1:14, the verse that we just read, Jesus is all truth. Truth also tells us that there is a direction. John chapter 3 and verse 21, listen to the direction. "But he who does the truth comes to the light." That is direction. "That his deeds may be clearly seen that they have been done in God." Truth, third, is who we worship. We don't worship a concept. We worship a person. John says in John 4 and verse 23, "The hour is coming and now is when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. Then he says that truth is also something that John, the apostle, or John, the Baptist, is witnessing too. He says in John 5 and verse 33, you have sent to John, and he has borne witness of the truth. How many remember what John said about Jesus Christ prior to Christ coming and being baptized by John the Baptist? John the Baptist says that there is the Christ, there is the Son of the living God. And then it was John the Baptist that said, he who is coming to you is mightier than I am. He is greater than I am. As a matter of fact, John the Baptist says, I can't even unloose the sandal strap from his sandals, but Jesus Christ is the one that has been witnessed to by the truth. We know this verse in John 8 and verse 32. Jesus said it this way, you shall know the truth, and what, church? And the truth will make you or set you free. John 14 and verse 6, we know this passage of Scripture very well. Truth will lead you to God. He said it this way. He said, and you, not only he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and then he says the direction, a way to God. No man comes to the Father except through me. Truth can be known. Truth can be recognized. That's what he says here in John chapter 1. But he also reveals it in John 14 and verse 17. The spirit of truth that the world cannot see because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. And then truth is also something that is someone that is revealed by the Holy Spirit. The role of the Holy Spirit is not to draw attention to himself. The role of the Holy Spirit is to draw attention to the Lord Jesus Christ, because Jesus said whenever he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak and he will tell you the things to come. But truth, Jesus, is also finally the one who will purify your life. Listen to what Jesus said, a simple short verse in John 17 and verse 17. He said, sanctify them by your truth, for thy word is truth. Well, let's just talk briefly this morning about the birth of Jesus Christ. And I want to give you three quick things here, and then we'll get into the four main things I want to call your attention to. I think you can go to the next screen here. I want to tell you these three things. Jesus' birth, first of all, was miraculous. Secondly, his birth was meek. And then third, his birth was manifested. All God's people would say amen to that. Let's just talk briefly about that. His birth, first of all, was miraculous. What does that mean? What is a miracle? I went to one of the dictionaries, and I didn't go to Webster. I went to Cambridge Dictionary. And here's the definition that it gave as what a miracle is. A miracle is an event that involves the direct and the powerful action of God transcending the laws of nature and defying common experiences. Let me just break that down for a second. A miracle is something that you cannot explain. Amen? It is something that happens. It is something that is not only supernatural, but it is something that is transcending and defies the laws of nature. Jesus' birth was the most unique birth in all of human history. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 1 and verse 20, it says that Mary was found to be with child by and through the Holy Spirit. That was a supernatural birth. Jesus says, I like what Adrian Rogers said, Jesus had an earthly mother, but he had a heavenly father. Would you say amen to that? And the Bible says that in Matthew chapter 1 and verse 25, that Joseph kept her, Mary, a virgin until she gave birth to a son and called his name Jesus. His birth was miraculous. Secondly, his birth was meek. Now, what does it mean to be meek? The word means to, meek means simple, plain, lonely. Jesus was born in a stable. He was born in a stall. The word humble carries some other definitions to it. It means to be low in rank. To be humble means to be brought down or to be brought down low. It means to bring something down. And the birth of our Savior Jesus Christ came by way of humble means. There was no fanfare. There was no big party. There was no big shouting. Now, the angel of God spoke to the shepherds that were out in the fields, and we do know that, but when they got to the birth of Jesus Christ and found the babe lying in a manger, there was no big fanfare. Listen to me, church. There was no reveal party. They blow up a balloon or shoot a gun or cut a cake to find out what the woman will end up having. By the way, I got to thinking about this a little bit, McKay. In this messed up world that we are in, where people don't know whether or not it's a boy or girl, a man or a woman, whether or not they are he or she, or she or he or an it or whatever. Can I get a little attention here this morning, church? If you watch every one of those reveal parties, whatever it might be, and I've been to a couple of them, and they shoot that streamer off, or they shoot a gun, or they blow up something, or whatever it might be, I'm going to get this all. And guess what? There's two colors that come out. One's either going to be blue, and one's either going to be pink. Would you say amen to that? And if it's a blue one, they're going to say, oh, she's having a... And if it's pink, they're saying, oh, she's having a... Thank you for that, for clarifying, and these messed up people in their minds not knowing whether or not it's a he or a she, it's a man or a woman. You're either going to have a boy or you're going to have a girl. Amen? You got people standing before Congress giving a witness and a testimony, and they say, well, what's the definition of a woman? And please give me my paycheck. They can't tell you the difference. There was no party at the fanfare to birth of Christ. No, there was no big deal about where Jesus would be born and how he'd come into this world. Not commercialized like Christmas is so much today. Christmas has turned into something that it was never intended to be. And I think maybe many of us, maybe most of us, are all guilty at perhaps sometime getting caught up in the entertainment of Christmas. I love the shows and I love the programs and I enjoy all those things, but sometimes I think we get off the kilter a little bit and we're going in a different direction. We have competitions in our homes. If you have more than one child or more than one grandchild, you can't have more than one person can't have five gifts and the other one have two gifts. Can I get a witness? You can't spend $100 on one and $20 on another one. You can't do that. Everything has got to be right. All these gifts have to be wrapped in this color, and all these have to be wrapped in this color. And that's not what Christmas is all about. One person said it this way. Symptoms of the same disorder are to be found away from Christmas celebration. Christian respectability and worldly respectability are scarcely different. Let me read that again. Christian respectability and worldly respectability are scarcely different. Christian books, tapes, films, evangelical ministers are packaged with a Hollywood image. The sweetheart of country music is not discernible from the sweetheart of gospel singing. Men of God look and sound more like the slick TV heartthrobs. Leaders study all the carnal methods of attracting notice. Bombastic personalities trumpet their own greatness and flaunt their ambition. All these things are incompatible with the modest, meek, humble Christ of the New Testament. Churches pat themselves on the back today, don't they? We like to do that. I think if you put the next screen up, maybe. No, don't worry about that. Take that back off. Go back to the last one. I'm not done with being on my rant this morning. If you look on that screen, I think maybe it's two down from that. You're going to see something that's going to say gimmick church or gospel church. There we go. Thank you. I got them out of order. Which one of these do you want? You want a gimmick church or you want a gospel church? Because what's being portrayed out there today are gimmick churches. And they're so-called churches, and they're patting themselves on the back, and they're doing things that I consider to be ungodly. And I'm not going to call a name out, but I'm just going to tell you, dear friends, there's churches even in our area. You can give out as much money that you want to. You can have all the fanfare and the partying that you want to. And you can have all the giveaways that you want to. But let me put this next quote up. Put that next quote up there, please. What you win them with is what you win them to. Now let's just sink in for just a moment, all right? What you win them with is what you're going to win them to. If you win them with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, you're going to win them to heaven. But if you try to win them through a means of gimmick and portrayal and whatever that might be, and game and whatever you might want to call it, you're going to lead them and you're going to win them to what I call shallow theology. And I want to tell you, dear friends, it's happening in our world. It's happening in our area. It's happening in places that maybe you've even seen before. They try to get people in by means of whatever the game is that brings them in. He said, well, whatever it takes to get them in. And I totally disagree with that. He said, well, I thought we were going to hear a message on Christmas. Well, you're going to hear the gospel, right? That's what I want to give you today, because what you win them is what you're going to win them to. One of our dear sweet ladies here in our church, a few years ago we were going to vacation Bible school, and I told the kids, I said, if you have a certain number in Bible school that evening, then they could throw a pie in my face. I didn't think much about it. And this dear sweet lady in our church called me up and said, Brother David, that's not respectable. Our kids should not be throwing a pie in the face of our leader. And I got to thinking about that, and she was right. I read something this week where one pastor made a bet with his congregation about how many people would come to church, and he lost the bet. So there on the stage, he ate cockroaches in front of everyone. People do different things. Show me in this book where you find that kind of behavior. Getting quiet. You say, well, you're just a fuddy-dud. You don't want to have fun. No. I'm interested and concerned for lost souls dying and going to a place called hell. And playing some kind of a game or advertising in such a way that you're going to give someone an experience doesn't get anyone to heaven. What gets a person to heaven is the gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ. And when he came in meek and mild form, in humble form, he didn't come to put on a party. He came to die for the sin of all mankind. So Jesus Christ, not only was his birth miraculous and his birth meek, but his worth was also manifested. The scripture says in verse number 14, it said, the word became flesh and dwelt among us. And that's what I want to talk about today, is the manifested birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you're ready this morning, for just a few moments before we partake of the elements, let me give you these four quick things. It's on the back of your bulletin. I want to answer four questions. Number one, when did Jesus become flesh? When did Jesus become flesh? Well, notice what it says here in verse 14. It said, the Word became flesh. A couple weeks ago on Wednesday night, we had our adult Bible study back in the back part in the fellowship hall back there, and we studied Galatians chapter 4, verse 4 and 5, and here's what that verse of Scripture said. It tells us when Christ came. When the fullness of time had come, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born under the law. John even tells us here in John chapter 1 and verse 1, he gives us a picture of the ever-existing Jesus Christ. He said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, when you look at John chapter 1 and verse 1, two things jump off the page at me. Are you still with me, church? Would you say amen? Two things jump off the page with me. The first one is this, that Jesus Christ, first of all, is the uncreated one. There is no beginning with God. He is the uncreated one. He has always been. He has forever existed. He is eternal. He is everlasting. He is forever. Jot this reference down. John 17, verse 4 and 5. Listen to what Jesus said. I glorified you here on the earth, having accomplished the work which you've given me to do. Now, Father, listen to what he says. Glorify me together with yourself with the glory which I had with you before the world was. And Jesus is saying and making reference to God the Father. He's praying that priestly prayer in John 17. He said, God, let me reveal that same glory that I had with you before the world was. So Jesus is the uncreated one, but also I want you to notice that Jesus is the one who created it all. He's the uncreated one. He lives forever, eternal, but he's also the one that creates it all. John chapter 1, verse 3 tells us, All things came into being through him. Genesis 1, in the beginning, God, the Trinitarian God, the Trinity, created the heavens and the earth. You might remember in Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2, where it's the creation of mankind, and the Bible says, let us make man in our image. That's a Trinitarian God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. God the Father, the one who created. God the Son, the one who came and died. God the Holy Spirit, the one who indwells us as a believer in Jesus Christ. Colossians chapter 2, chapter 1, Paul even refers to the all-creating God that we have. He said, for by him all things were created, both in the heaven and on the earth, visible, invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. For he is, listen, before all things, and in him all things are held together. Question number one, when did Jesus become flesh? Well, the Bible says when he came here to earth. But in the spiritual realm, he has always existed. Question number two, how did Jesus become flesh? Well, he also tells us in verse 14, it says, and the Word became flesh, and here it is, dwelt among us. As I mentioned to you before, Jesus could have come as an adult, but he didn't. God saw fit to bring his son Jesus into the world the same way that you and I have come into this world, through a natural childbirth. Ray Stedman, one of the Bible commentators that I like to follow, listen to, and read, he gives a good explanation of what this word to dwell means in John chapter 1, verse 14. He said that Jesus came and set up his tent among us. Jesus came and camped out among human flesh. He said, well, give me a better explanation. You remember when the Bible says that Mary would be indwelt by the Holy Spirit? Nod your head like you remember seeing that verse, hearing that verse. Well, what did Jesus do by the work of the Holy Spirit? Jesus came and took up residency in the womb of Mary. And not only did Jesus come and take up residency in the womb of Mary, Jesus also was born to take up residency in our hearts as a believer in him. It's interesting what happens here in this passage of Scripture in John 1 and verse 14. Because two things happen here. There's spiritual and there's physical. Notice what it said. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. You say, well, where's the physical? Flesh. Where's the spiritual? It talks about the Word, the ever-eternal God. His glory as the glory of the only begotten of the Father. So there's the physical and the spiritual. Let me give you a better illustration. Everybody look up for just a moment. Physically, I have a suit on. Physically, here on earth, we're living in a suit. I mean, this is the outward part. When you die and you have my funeral, we have your funeral, we're going to see a representation of who you are. That's the outside. That's your body. But we also have something that's called a soul. And Jesus didn't come to die for your body. Jesus came to die for your soul. Are you still with me? Amen. The reason why that is so true is because we have the Adamic nature, the nature of Adam. The Bible says because of the sin of Adam and Eve, we are now a depraved state. The moment that you are born, you begin the decaying, dying process on the body part. That's the physical. But we also have a soul, and that soul is where the Spirit of Christ lives. Paul gives a good illustration of this in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 and 20. You know this verse, but listen to what he says. Or do you not know that your body, physical, is a temple of the Holy Spirit, spiritual, who is in you, whom you have from God, spiritual, that you are not your own, physical, for you have been bought with a price, physical, therefore glorify God in your body, physical. So what he's saying is this. What people see on the outside, the physical part, they ought to see as a representation of what really is going on inside, and that's the spiritual part. You've heard this phrase, a walking dead man. Heard that phrase before? If you haven't, you heard it today for the first time. What does that mean? Well, we know what it means. It means something different in a prison realm, in a criminal realm. What that means is someone that is getting ready to go to death row. But in a spiritual realm, what we're talking about is if you do not know Christ as your personal Savior and Lord, you can have the biggest smile on your face. You can carry the biggest Bible that you want to. You can come to church every Sunday that you want to. You can dress up in whatever clothes that you want to, and you can still be a dead man on the inside. And there are people today, over 80% of people in Barron County are not attending a church somewhere today. I don't know if all of those are lost without Christ. Many of them probably are. But the angel told Mary that this would happen. And the angel said to Mary, said, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And for that reason, the Holy Child shall be called the Son of God. Question number one, when did he become flesh? Question number two, how did he become flesh? Question number three, what happened when Jesus became flesh? He gives the answer in John chapter 1 and verse 11. Look in your Bibles. It says in verse 11, it said, he came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. What happened when Jesus became flesh? Remember I said no fanfare? And then the Bible tells us that he was circumcised. Then the Bible says that he was, dedicated there at the temple. And then the Bible picks it up and tells us when he was 12 years old, and then from 12 to the age of 30. We don't really have anything in the Bible that tells us about Christ, but we believe Luke chapter 2, verse 52 says he began to grow in wisdom and knowledge and stature and in favor with God and man. But we have here in this passage of Scripture in John 1 and verse 11 that Christ's mission was to go to his own people, the Jews, but the Jews did not receive him. Would the Jews receive any judgment? Well, he gives the answer in John 3:19. Here is the judgment, that light is coming to the world, and men love the darkness rather than the light, for their deeds are evil. Jot this reference down. It's in Luke chapter 20. In Luke chapter 20, there's an interesting parable that Jesus gives. Because we're answering the question, why or what happened when he became flesh? In Luke chapter 20, I think it's verse 9 through 16, the Bible says that Jesus gave them a parable, and here's the parable. He said, a man who owned a vineyard handed off his vineyard to some other workers, and he went on a journey. And the Bible says, it doesn't say he went on a long journey. The Bible says he went on a journey, listen, and was gone for a long time. So he could have went across the street, been gone for a long time. Y'all with me? Now we know that's talking about Jesus. And we know that Christ has yet to come back for his church, rapture the church out, so it's been over 2,000 years. So Jesus gives this illustration, this parable. He said, here's a man who owns this vineyard, and he's going to hand this vineyard off to some other people that's representing the Jews, and he's going to give them care of it. Now, after a certain amount of time, this man who owned the vineyard started sending some of his people, his servants, to go reap some of the harvest, because the Bible said at harvest time, he sent a slave, he sent a servant. Those servants are what we understand to be the prophets of God in the Old Testament, even John the Baptist. And one of the servants came, and the Bible says that they didn't give him any of the harvest. They didn't give him anything from the vineyard. And you can check your pastor out there in Luke chapter 20. Go home and read it if you want to. And one of those people came, the servants came, and they beat him, and they sent him away and cast him away. And then the owner of the vineyard, he said, well, I'm going to send a second servant. And he sent a second servant, same thing. Mistreated, ridiculed, beaten, cast away, sent away, left for dead. Then he sends a third servant. Same thing. The Bible tells us in Luke chapter 20, tells us this about that third servant. It says that he proceeded to send another slave, and they beat him up, and proceeded to send a third, and this one they also wounded, and they cast him out. Then the owner of the vineyard, everybody still with me? Then the owner of the vineyard said, what shall I do? I will send my beloved son. Perhaps they will respect or honor him. But when the vineyard growers saw him, they reasoned with one another, saying, this is their heir, is the heir. Let us kill him so that the inheritance will be ours. So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? So here's the picture. You know the synopsis, what I'm going to say. Prophet after prophet after prophet after prophet is sent to the Jews, and the Jews continue to reject the coming of the Messiah and the message of the Messiah. God the Father said, I'm going to send my son, Philippians chapter 2. I'm going to send my son in the form of humankind, and I'm going to send him to save the Jews, my own people. And then the Bible says that they rejected him, and they killed him. Then the scripture says he will come and destroy the vine growers and give that vineyard to others. Interesting. He'll come and destroy the vine growers. Who's that? Well, that's the Jews. Then he'll give the vineyard to others. Who's that? That's the Gentiles. Nod your head like you understand what the preacher's saying today, okay? What he's saying there is this, dear friends, and I want you to understand. What happened to Jesus when he became flesh? They killed him. Well, let me correct myself. They didn't kill him because he gave his life willingly. They thought they were doing away with the Son of God. They thought that they were putting away the Son of God, but Jesus prepared his disciples over and over again for three and a half years, telling them that I'm going to Jerusalem, and when he gets to Jerusalem, he's going to die. The Bible has much to say about what happened when Christ came and why he came. He came to seek and to save the lost. He came to give his life a ransom for many. He came to give light to those in darkness, the Jews and maybe some that are here today. He came to redeem lost men back to the Father. He came to do the will of God the Father. He came to be the perfect sacrifice for our sins. And what happened to Jesus? He died on a cruel cross. The sinless one. Paul said, he who knew no sin became sin for us that we might become the righteous of God. When did he become flesh? How did he become flesh? What happened to him when he became flesh? And finally this morning, why did he become flesh? I think the answer is in John chapter 1 and verse 12. I believe the answer is in verse 12. It says here in verse 12 of John chapter 1, it says, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name. Now, I want to parse this verse out for just a moment this morning, and just give me a moment, but look at that verse. Everybody there in verse 12? It says, first of all, the first phrase that I've highlighted is, as many as received him. Didn't say everyone, it said as many as received him. So did Jesus come? Did he die for the sin of all mankind? Well, Jesus came and he died. He shed his blood so that all mankind would come to everlasting life, but we know that not every person is going to believe the gospel. So the first phrase is, as many received him. The second phrase that I'd call your attention to is, he gave. Who gave? God gave. What did he give? He gave the right to become children of God. Listen, my dear friends, you don't get to heaven on your own thought process. You don't get to heaven on your own terms. There's only one way, there's only one truth, and there's only one life, and his name is Jesus. He gave. What did he give? He gave you a right to become children of God. Does that give us any authority? Well, you better believe it does, because the Bible says, as a child of God, I can now climb up in the Lord's lap and cry out, Abba, Father, Daddy, Daddy. I can run to him. I have access. I have boldness. I have ability to now come to the throne of God through Jesus Christ did, and I can come to him directly and not have to go through anyone. By the way, if you're following any news, did you see what the Pope, that ungodly person, said this past week? Oh, I just got your dander up. Now the Catholic Church said it's okay for gay, lesbian, homosexual marriages. So, well, Christianity is the largest religion in the world. No, it's not. Catholicism is. And when the Pope speaks, he speaks as what is called ex cathedra. I'm just throwing this in for a little food for thought today, okay? You can talk around your dinner table today about what the preacher said. But when the Pope speaks, he speaks ex cathedra, as in on the part of God, on the part of Christ, that when he speaks, the church listens and the church has to follow his orders. Aren't you glad you don't have to go through anyone for someone else to forgive you of your sins, dear friends? That ought to be a hearty amen. When Jesus Christ died on the cross, the Bible says that the veil in the temple was rent in two, and that big veil was rent in two, and now I have access to God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ, and I can come directly to him. Because no sinful man can forgive sin. Only a sinless Savior can forgive sin, and his name is Jesus. As many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name. Christ came to die. He came to die so that we might live. Amen? So, let me ask you a question this morning. Have you received him? Because the scripture says, as many as believed in him, received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. So have you received him? Have you trusted him? Have you invited Christ into your heart to be your personal Savior and Lord? Because if you haven't, the Bible says there is a day coming. It's called a judgment day. And John chapter 3 said, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. And he who believes in him is not judged, but he who does not believe has already been judged, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Are your Bibles still open? I'm going to close by giving you just a three-point little closing to John chapter 1 and verse 14. Three words. Here they are. They're not going to be on the screen. Word number one, incarnation. That means in flesh. So, well, where is it? And the Word became flesh. That's incarnation. Second word that I give you is the word observation. It's there in verse 14 as well. Because the scripture says, John says, not only did the Word become flesh, incarnation, but John says, we saw him. That's observation. John even says in 1 John, he says, our hands have handled him, my eyes have seen, our ears have heard, that we have touched and tasted of the Word of God, the Word of life. So there's incarnation, there's observation. The third word I'll give you is exaltation. Well, where is it? Notice what it says. John says, we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and what? Truth. The incarnation, for the Word became flesh. The observation, we saw him. The exaltation, we saw his glory. Pretty cool. Two real quick things. One is this. They saw Jesus. People see you. Maybe a bad illustration. I think I've got a picture on here. I think we go to this picture. I don't like the camp. Live out in a tent. Some of you love that stuff. I'll pray for you. But if you're out in the woods and you set up a tent and it gets dark outside, you can't see that tent. But all of a sudden, somebody turns a little light on in that tent. You know what you see? You see the glow coming from that tent. John said, when the Word became flesh, we not only saw Jesus in human form, we saw the glory of God coming from within him and outside of him. Matthew 17, the transfiguration of Christ. Let me put it down in your lap here this morning before we partake of the elements, and that's this. When people see you, do they see an empty tent, or do they see someone who has the glory and the Spirit of Almighty God living inside of you that is just being expressed in every way? Because when we come together for a time like this at Christmas, there's only one gift that you need if you've not received it, and that is Jesus. I think I've got one more screen. You all know this. We call this the Roman Road. And let me just walk you down this road. And this road is not going to lead you to a dark tunnel. This road is going to lead you to light. It's going to lead you to the true light. Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You know that verse? Romans 6:23. For the wages of that sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus the Lord. You see, if you died in that sin, the wages of that sin is death, physical, spiritual death. Romans chapter 5 and verse 8, Paul goes on, he said, but God commended, God gave his love, God commended his love toward us. I love what he says. While we were yet a sinner, Christ died for us. That's good news. So why are you throwing John 3:16 in there? Because I can. Because you need it. That is the verse that is probably the key verse in the entire Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in him shall not perish but have eternal everlasting life. That's the one that holds it all together. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. You see, dear friends, when you get saved, you're no longer a secret disciple. You're a proclaimer of the gospel of Christ. Romans 10:13. For whosoever, everybody say that, whosoever. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. What a promise from God. Amen. And he is having his arms open, welcoming people that would come to him by faith and those who would believe in him. And you say, well, preacher, all of us here in this building know Jesus as their personal Savior and Lord. You may be someone that knows Christ as personal Savior and Lord. If you do, your name is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. But, dear friends, I guarantee you every person in this room knows someone who is yet to pray and invite Christ into their heart to be their personal Savior and Lord. It is that individual that needs the gospel. And we're the ones who are the ambassadors. We carry the message. We proclaim the message. We tell the good news that Jesus Christ has come. Amen. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'm just asked Julie just to come and play softly for just a moment. And if you need to come this morning just to pray, there's plenty of room for you to come and pray. Maybe you're here today, you'd like to give your life to Christ. We'd love for you to be able to share with you how you could know how to do that, and Jesus could come into your life. Maybe you're here today and you're not where you ought to be before we take the elements this morning, the bread and the juice, and there's no salvation in these elements. It's just a symbolic gesture of what we are doing, but it is a representation that one day we're going to do this with Christ. We don't have to do it anymore. We'll be at the marriage supper of the Lamb, but Scripture tells us to make sure that you examine your own life. If you are in a right relationship with him, maybe you're here today and you've been coming to this church. You'd like to join our fellowship, become a member of Southside Baptist Church. We'd love to have you. We'd love to have you to become part of our fellowship, our ministry, and to take part in what God is doing here at Southside. But maybe there's someone here today that you've been talking to, you've been witnessing to, you've been sharing the gospel with. You think you're close. Don't know what else it's going to take. I tell you what it won't take. It won't take a gimmick. It's always the gospel. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. If anyone needs to come, as Miss Julie is playing this morning, invite you to come just to pray. If no one comes, we'll move into the remainder of our service. Dear Jesus, we love you, we praise you. God, thank you so much for the opportunity just to sing some praises today and to hear the spoken word, the word that draws us to yourself. Lord, thank you so much for your truth. Thank you that in you is truth. And Father, we pray, Lord, that we don't search and we don't run after the things of the world, but we run to Christ. Lord, would you help us to understand that, not just today in this time of year, but every day of our life. Help us to put the world in perspective, but put a heaven right before our very eyes, that there is a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. And Lord, help us to tell other people about Jesus. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. You remain seated where you are. If I can have Bobby Shortridge, Bobby Bishop up here, we're going to do the Lord's Supper a little bit different. And we have open communion here at Southside. So if you're a believer in Christ,